Hey everyone, it's Twinkie Chan coming at you from San Francisco. I am a little bummed that I cannot be in Dallas today to give you a personal tour of my installation at Sweet Tooth Hotel. However, I thought it could also be fun to take you behind the scenes, take you around my craft space slash studio slash dining room. It's all the same thing. You can see in this space the projects that are sort of in progress and that I'm working on. And the really fun part, the really special part, is I'm going to show you a fun tutorial on how I put together my crocheted cakes. We'll be making a mini version of the heart-shaped cake you can see in the installation right now. And I'll be providing a link, a never seen before link, to a pattern so all the crocheters out there can crochet a mini heart cake of their own. And even if you're not a crocheter, I think it can be fun to see sort of the different elements that can go behind putting together a little crocheted dessert, because there is some non-crochet that goes in it too. And there'll probably be some tips and tricks that come up along the way. Of course, if you ever have specific questions about the installation, you can always message me on Facebook or Instagram. I'm Twinkie Chan on all social media, except for YouTube, Twinkie Chan TV, which I'm not really that active on anymore, but there are some free crochet tutorials there as well. So let's take a look at the space. I think that mostly what people want to see is the yarn wall. People who love yarn love to look at other people's yarn. And this is all organized in bookshelves and old CD cases from IKEA. I don't think they make them anymore because no one's really making CDs anymore, but that's how old school I am. Those little guys are CD cases. And this table is not, I don't like having a table in front of it. It kind of mars the beauty of the yarn wall, but this extra table's come in handy for when I have to shoot video tutorials for work sometimes, and right now it seems to be like a holding space for some projects that I'm working on. Sorry about my big old finger. Just to show you the yarn a little bit more, it is roughly rainbow organized and sort of organized by brand and fiber as well. So there's a lot of acrylic on this side, your Lion Brand Brandon's Choice, your Red Heart Super Saver, kind of coming into wool acrylic blends. This is just a bunch of different brands, and I used to also really like, it's not coming to me now, but let's take this ball of yarn. Universal Yarn used to make a classic worsted that was an acrylic wool blend. I really liked it. I think they phased it out because, you know, they always discontinue your favorites. I used to use a lot of Cascade 220. I use it a lot less now, but the colors of Cascade 220 are so amazing. It's a sort of a lighter weight worsted wool yarn. It's kind of scratchy. I wouldn't use it, but for some of my amigurumi or my stuffed toys, it's beautiful. Over here is the more high quality wool. Malabrigo is one of my favorite brands. It comes in all different heavinesses. I can't think of all different weights. Their colors are also beautiful, and it's like the softest merino wool you'll ever touch. I'm really sensitive to wool, but Malabrigo merino is beautiful. And here, oh, there's my zipper collection, some party hats and a monkey, of course. And just more acrylic. This is a lot of Vanna's Choice in here. This little pink shelf somehow has my sunglasses collection on it and some art. And just a lot of finishings and doodads like buttons. There's some eyeballs in here. What else is in here? I don't know, like little bags that I use to package things when I ship them. You know, snow cone thingies. You always need snow cone thingies. On the table, it sort of ended up being a works in progress situation. I saw this crocheted dress and I really wanted to make one of my own. And it's sometimes enjoyable to work on other people's patterns too. It was actually really relaxing to not be writing a pattern while I was making something. But, you know, as life is, sometimes you can't finish all your... Oh, there's Alf too. I have an Alf phone. He looks really disturbed, kind of wrapped up in a cord like that, but... We used him for a video, so that's why he's kind of chilling there, not being plugged into anything. Anyway, here's half of a dress, or maybe a third of a dress. And then another personal project I wanted to work on was making my own straw hat. This is a really cool Wool in the Gang raffia. It's perfect for hats and bags. But yeah, I have a really big head. And I could never find a hat that fit me, so I was like, I'll make my own. This is, I know this is like super granny-tastic, but I recently launched a how-to crochet class on Creative Bug. So if you guys are fans of crochet but don't know how to do it, you can always go to Creative Bug and look for my beginning crochet class there. And we made some baubles in one of the days of this class. And I was like, oh, for fun, I'll try to make like kind of a granny 70s sweater or like a little short-sleeved cardigan. But I ran out of time to shoot it for the class. And I'm hoping that I'll one day take a moment to finish that because I just think it'll be really funny. It's funny to me. Sometimes you just make things that are funny to yourself. Here's some foam that's left over from the installation. If you're wondering what's inside the bags of flour and sugar, it's foam. I liked how it kept its shape more than just stuffing them with regular polyfill stuffing. So that's a tip for you if you want to crochet something that needs to keep a sort of rectangular or cubic, you know, squarish, flat surfacey shape. Foam is always a nice way to go, and you can buy this at craft stores. I found that it was cheaper to buy a really big sheet on Amazon, order from Amazon or not, as you will. They do have a better deal on foam, but you can also get it at like Michael's and Joanne. I have a lot of cake forms, faux cake forms left over from the show as well. You can see some down here too. And these little guys are so cute. These little tiny heart-shaped cake forms, and these are the little cakes that we'll be making in the tutorial in a couple minutes. Here's my computer. Hi guys. It's where I do all my editing, whether it's photo editing or video editing, and packaging and shipping product when I used to do that, and just a fun gallery wall full of inspiration. A lot of this is art and photography by my friends. So there's a picture of family and friends in Tokyo and stuff that people have given me. I have a banana sanctuary. That's not something you already knew about me. Twinkie Chan's banana sanctuary. I have a thing for like plush bananas. I don't know what it is, but yeah, banana art. I just think it's funny. I have a mess of glue guns and various paper punches that I also will punch felt with for my crochet projects. And poor little Groot, this guy, this is probably one of my most posted projects. Like, people love making Groot and posting him on Instagram. I don't often crochet characters. Like, I kind of just like to stick with my own original stuff rather than basing it off of someone else's intellectual property. But I mean, he was so cute, like I could not help myself. And this is a free pattern on my blog, and I also have a YouTube tutorial for that. So if you're a big fan of Groot, I'm here for you. There's also a ton of glue, which we'll get into with our tutorial as well. I use a couple different types of glue depending on what we're gluing together. Some of these bins are filled with projects that I'm working on. I have a lot of books that I want to write, and this is getting ready to shoot photography for a book about bento box lunches, crocheted bento box lunches. Those are Japanese box lunches where oftentimes all the food is shaped really cute. Like this is a ham and cheese sandwich that looks like a puppy. And I've done a couple art shows with these bento boxes and thought it would be a really cute foundation for a little book on how to crochet a bunch of tiny little foods. I still have some leftover goodies from the installation stuff that I didn't end up using. Like, you'll recognize these from the tops of my cream puff towers and some of the other desserts in the show. I really love their vintage raspberry beads. I bought a ton of beads because I thought I was going to use them to decorate that big wedding cake in the corner. I did not end up using these. This is also some trim that I bought that I thought I was going to use for the cake. I know it's like super tacky, but I don't know. I kind of still love it. I just didn't use it on the cake. And in here are a bunch of sprinkles that I did use in the show. You can see those on the birthday cake. And what else did I use these on? Maybe just the birthday cake. You guys, I haven't been in the installation for so long, I can't remember, but there are some other things that I used, like little sprinkles for the cheeks on the teddy bear cakes. Oh, also the star cakes. The star cakes have a lot of sprinkles. I think, unfortunately, the star-shaped cakes didn't get a lot of love just simply because of where I had to put them in the bookcase, but if you go visit, go say hi to the star cakes. Sorry if you can hear my neighbor's children screaming. Just random office stuff, a mailing scale, washi tape, some gear for the camera, some other collection-y things, and just sort of leftover and extra pieces from other projects. I don't know if some of you recognize the Freak Shake that I wrote for Molly Makes Magazine, and these are just some prototypes of the cream puff towers that are currently in the show at Sweet Tooth Hotel. Let's see, is there anything else fun in here? I have a whole donut wall, but these are some other donuts that I just happen to have at home. It's a froggy, Hello Kitty, and Gloomy Bear. Forgot to show you guys this bin. Sometimes it's hard to calculate what you will need for an installation, and you can plan and plan and plan, but once you get everything in there, stuff changes. This is a box full of marshmallow bunnies that are extra. And I don't know, I might finish them and maybe put them on Etsy or something if people are interested in purchasing a bag of marshmallow bunnies. And I also have a ton of these teddy bear bread rolls because at first I thought I was going to make rings out of them, like six of these guys forming a circle, but there was just no room for them in the installation, so we just put them in a basket. You can see there's some unfinished donuts in here from the donut wall, or like ones that I didn't want to put up because the glue got messy. My mom helped me with a lot of gluing and, you know, human error. Sometimes they don't all look beautiful. This guy looks fine. He just needs a nose. So you might recognize that guy and his friends from the donut wall. There's actually some other stuff left over underneath this table too from the installation. This is a box full of my favorite faux cherries, which we'll get into for the tutorial. These are boxes that I packed to take with me when I was finishing my installation, when I went to Dallas, like a week before shelter in place started, basically. And so here we have a bin full of plastic eyes, a lot of plastic eyes in my work. What is this? This looks like a lot of glue, syringes for glue, all different kinds of glue. And this is, looks like pom-poms. I think I used to have my sprinkles in here. There's some raspberry beads. This box is a bunch of yarn I have left over that was donated from Red Heart.
And I do want to write a book of the patterns that are in the installation. So I'm definitely holding on to all the yarn because I will definitely need it for that project.
If you can humor me for a minute, I really want to show you this other project that I worked on in the past 2 weeks. It's not yarn related, and I know this is supposed to be a celebration of yarn, but if you want to get a really good idea of what it's like to work in my space, like, I can't leave this part out. And it's in the living room where I actually do most of my crocheting in front of the TV.
It's a Little Shop of Horrors inspired Halloween tree, and there's not a single fiber of yarn on it, but it's definitely DIY, and it's kind of like having our own installation here in our own home, which is really cool. Like, we're kind of into decorating, but it hasn't felt to this level before. And a lot of people are asking what these Audreys are made out of, and they're just paper mache over a balloon with lots of paint. And people are asking about the inside of the mouth, and it's just tissue paper covered in more tissue paper. And this tongue is just paper. It's two pieces of paper that I glued together and I stuffed the center. And this part of the mouth, we were thinking of different ways to create this idea, and we ended up using, it's like spandex, like exercise fabric, and I cut holes in it and just stretched it out, and it's just hot glued all up in there. And my roommate hand painted all of these like petally parts and these leaves. It's just like a big sheet of like butcher paper. And she also glittered and painted these paper vines, and they're wired to give them a little bit more structure. We wrapped this ivy, this faux ivy, all over everything, and it was just a fun way to pull together all of our house plants, both real and fake. So it's a fun thing to look at night while I'm crocheting my projects. We'll head back to the craft room where we'll get set up and make our mini crocheted heart cake together. This is not going to be a crochet tutorial, just so it can still be interesting for people who aren't crocheters yet. I've done all the crocheting on this cake already, and this is from the pattern that I'm gonna link again below that no one has seen yet. It's just released now, and if there are any errors on it, just let me know, because it's so fresh and I haven't had anyone's eyeballs on it except me. The pattern will tell you how to crochet this heart-shaped panel, and you crochet two of them, and then you crochet a side panel, and then you sew them together. The next part of the pattern has you make these bobble frosting pieces, which you'll see a lot of in the installation. It's one of my favorites to create the look of frosting, and you end up with this one long yarn tail. So what I do is I start with the top one, and the top one has 15 bobbles on it, and I'll pin one of the ends to the center, kind of, what do you call this part of the butt crack of the, is that what I can say? The butt crack of the heart. And since there's an odd number of bobbles, one of them will sit at the bottom of the heart, the tip of the heart. And here what I'll do is, I won't pin the very end because I want to put a stitch here with my tapestry needle. I'll put a pin in the one right next to it right here. And to secure this while you're sewing it, you can put a couple more pins. Like, I'll put a pin probably around the center point. And the foam is cool too, because you can put the pin right in it. I wouldn't poke too many pins in it because you're starting to ruin the integrity of the foam, but it is helpful for pinning your pieces together. I'll probably, just so this doesn't move around too much while I'm sewing, pin it in a couple more places. Like there, and it doesn't have to be symmetrical here. So I'm pinning in between the bobbles. I'm not pinning onto a bobble. I'm actually not going to sew
into this bauble area either. I'm always using these spaces between the baubles to attach this strip of frosting to the cake. And that way you don't ruin what the baubles look like since you worked so hard to make them beautiful in your crochet. I'm taking my tapestry needle, threading this through, and attaching and attaching the end of this frosting to the cake. So I'll run my needle through a stitch or two of the cake. Attach at the end here. I give it another one just to be a little more secure. And so that I don't smush the puffy shape of my bauble. I'm probably gonna move this pin here. What I'm gonna do is travel my needle underneath the bauble so you can't see the yarn, and then come back up in the space between a bauble. Might be a little weird on camera, but so I'm inserting my needle and see how it's going underneath the bauble and into the pink cake. You can come back out up through the cake and the frosting. See how my needle's coming back out? Pull through. My yarn is nice and hidden underneath this first bauble, and then I'll secure here with a stitch or two. It doesn't take that many to secure it. One, maybe one more. Make sure you're getting some of that cake, that darker pink cake yarn as well. So you're securing the bauble to the pink cake. And then I'll dive back in here, making sure I'm traveling my needle underneath the bauble and underneath the pink cake layer, coming back up on the other side of the bauble again. And I think it's helpful also to use my left hand to help pull the tapestry needle through. And you do the same thing. You put a couple stitches up here to attach this part of the bauble to the cake. I just keep going around doing that all the way around. And I'm trying to keep this frosting kind of more, less on the side and more on top, because we're gonna stick our cherries on top right here. So keep that in mind as you're attaching this frosting as well. More on top, not so much on the side. So I'm gonna go all the way around and do that. After you tie your final knot, you can hide your yarn tail underneath the dark pink cake. And you take your second, slightly longer piece of frosting and pin it along the bottom and sew the same thing. There's one extra bauble just so you're able to stretch it a little more around the sides. So there'll be 8 baubles on one side of the heart and 8 baubles on the other side of the heart. But it's sewn on in the exact same way. Once these frosting bits are sewn in, it's time to decide what you want on the top of your cake. You can have words, you can just put a bunch of sprinkles, you can do whatever you feel like. This particular cake I'm making right now is for a friend who sent me a mask. It was beautiful, it was pink and red, super cute, with hearts all over it, and she didn't charge me for it. So I told her I would send her something back. So I was gonna make her a little cake because we kind of share the same aesthetic or a similar aesthetic. And I asked her what word she would want, and her dog's name is Glitter. So I'm going to use this crochet chain in white yarn to create the cursive word glitter on here. And this is a small cake. This cake is, I think, is it 6 inches wide? And when you start making letters with yarn, it, you know, can end up being bigger and longer than you would hope. So glitter is kind of a lot of letters to stretch across here. I'm gonna do my best. What I do is I start crocheting a chain, and you can see here, here's the loop. I made it really big so the chains wouldn't come undone, and I don't break it off because I lay out the letter, I pin some places down, I start attaching it, and in case I run out of chains, I can pop my hook back in here and create more chains just in case I need extra. So I start pinning and gluing down the other end, and same with this tail because I use that to tuck into the cake as well. So I'm gonna do all lowercase letters in cursive. And what I do is I start laying it out. I start trying to lay it out. It can be tricky and time consuming, but you can just think about all the letters you see in my installation, and this is how they were all applied. And I'll start trying to imagine what this will look like. And you can tell it's gonna be really tight. So you wanna try to pick a short word if possible. In this case, I didn't wanna say, no, your dog's name is too long. So I'm gonna do my best. And you sort of manipulate the chain. And get an idea of the spacing, right? So this is really tight. I know that doesn't look like anything right now. That's what they always look like in the beginning. What I'm gonna try to do is make this G a little smaller, make the L a little tighter, make sure all these letters fit. And then I might pin down the very beginning of the letter. And what I use for this is I don't sew it down. I use Fabri-Tac, which is a really great fabric glue. It, you know, it doesn't dry instantly, but it dries very quickly. And I would say the dry time is about on par with a hot glue gun. So, you know, not immediate, but pretty fast. And what I do is I apply the glue carefully to the bottom of my chain, like an inch at a time, especially around a curve. I might do like an inch at a time, hold it down, and go and place my yarn and lift it up under here and put more glue and glue it down. And you have to wait a little bit too, because if you manipulate the yarn too much and the glue's not dry, you're just ruining the spots that you just glued down. So it takes some patience. And you keep just manipulating and gluing down a little bit. You want to be careful with the glue so your project doesn't get gluey. And just keep going and gluing and arranging. Just to get it going, just like half an inch. I just want to get a good anchor down. And you don't need to babysit it too much, but I would pat it down and give it like, I don't know, 45 seconds and come back and pat it down again. There's a lot of gluing and patting and arranging the yarn. It's a whole thing. You might be wondering why I'm gluing and not sewing. And I find that when you try to sew down chains, it can really change the appearance of them because you start tugging at loops on the chain. And if you glue it, you're not affecting the chain at all. So it could even go more quickly if you sew. And if you prefer that, you can go ahead and use a really long yarn tail to sew it down. But my just preferred method and preferred aesthetic is with the Fabri-Tac. Okay, I'm not gonna lie, that was a really tight fit. I'm at the end of the R, and you can see I have quite a bit of extra chain left. So I'm just gonna pull those chains out. Like leave a little bit here to tuck in. to the cake, and I'm going to trim that. And then pull that tail through to break off the chain. Pull it tight. And then I'll go in with my tapestry needle and tie like one knot here to the pink cake. And the beginning tail too, I'll tie one knot down to the cake and then hide the tail inside of it. For the literal cherry on top, these are my favorite faux cherries, and I have a link to where I buy them in your PDF pattern. I don't tell people where I get them when they ask me on social media, but since you guys have joined for this Facebook Live today, it's my very special present to you. It's to give you my source for these faux cherries that everyone wants so much. So get about 6 to 8 of them. It really depends on what look you're going for. You can play with them, arrange them around. In my PDF, I note that this textile glue is the one glue that I think works really well with these cherries. Because these are a flexible plastic, most glues will peel right off. Like hot glue doesn't work, that Fabri-Tac doesn't work, super glue doesn't work. So if you don't want to purchase this, because actually they don't sell it in America, you have to buy it from someone on Etsy or Amazon, and it ships from Europe if it's from Amazon, and if it's from Etsy, it's probably someone who's bought a bunch from Europe and is selling it in the US. So it can take a while to arrive to you, and if you don't have the patience for it, again, feel free to experiment. I find that it's the best for these cherries, and it's a good glue too for other things. Just that it's kind of special, and I try not to use it if there's another glue that can be used in its stead. So what I do is I find the bottom of the cherry, I put a good dollop on it. It's kind of a slimy glue, it won't feel like it's sticking to the bottom of the cherry very much. And then I place it where I want it and kind of give it a little twist, seem like kind of twisting it down into the surface. Gonna hold it down for a little bit. This also dries really quickly, so you don't have to babysit it. And I wouldn't mess with it very much. Just kind of let it do its gluey thing. It does set very quickly though, so you wanna make sure you're putting the cherry exactly where you want it. I'm doing one more little dollop, and find your surface, place it, give it a good twist like that. Okay, at the last minute, I decided to throw on basically all the cherries. I figured for a dog named Glitter, he deserves all the cherries in the world. I might also add a frosting flourish here down at the bottom, just to sort of balance out this empty space. You could also go in on the side and add more squiggles or, you know, frosting arcs, or I guess icing arcs. There's a lot of room for creativity in this project, which is what I really, really love about it. You can be basic, extra, switch up the colors, throw on sprinkles. Pretty much anything you want to do. It's a really great canvas. It's going to end up looking super cute and delicious no matter what you do. Don't forget to grab that PDF. I don't know if I'm going to release that anytime soon, so you can be the first to have it. I can't wait to see all of your crocheted cakes. Please tag me, Twinkie Chan, on social media so I can see them. I know they're going to be beautiful. I hope you find a lot of inspiration in my space. I do every day, mostly because of the yarn wall, because, you know, we love yarn so much. So thank you again, and have a lot of fun.